We are part of the border. We are on iHeartRadio today. AMFM247.com. I can't say the P word here. Damn it. Talk Shoe. iHeartRadio. All those things. We are going to go to Roger Homefield, who is going to join us live on the big show. The fantastic Roger Homefield, according to Skype, is waiting for me to join the call. So we are going to go to the fantastic Roger Homefield. There he is, Joe Citizen himself, the original ferret in a jello fight, the fantastic Roger Homefield. He is a ferret in jello fight, and that jello fight, just amazing, amazing. But we go from, you know, if you're listening to this on because of course I can't say the P word because we are on radio, so I can't say the P word, but I can say on demand archived audio. I just think it would be a lot easier just say podcast. But fantastic Roger Homefield is with us, and if you go to our website, which is JIGGYGUAR.com, you can get all of Roger's past commentaries, including his I guess you would just call that a promo last week he cut on half the world. that is up there in all its glory over there at JiggyJaguar.com. Roger missed his calling being a professional wrestler or being a professional wrestling manager. Some of the things that he says and does on this show is just absolutely amazing. And your friend, my friend, and everybody's friend, dollars to donuts, and let's hope he brought the donuts. The fantastic Roger Homefield. How are you, sir?
Jiggy, always great to see you. But you know, the things I say are not, there's nothing remarkable about. All I'm doing is saying what's going on. I mean, I'm not doing
well. Yeah, well, yeah,
I'm not defunding the police, but it's all craziness.
Yeah,
so what went through my mind, Jiggy, is you know, the vilification of Trump has been so complete.
You know, ironically, I before we got Roger on, we taped an episode of our, as I call it, the porn show, and we had there's some of these porn stars. I need to have you interview them at some point. But the thing is, and Roger will of course do it with you know, all the professionalism that he usually does, but you know, he'll take the bullet and interview the porn stars, but. We were talking about getting rejected for, you know, interviews or getting rejected for this or getting rejected for that. And one of the things that I said is I used to get a lot of the political people, the PR people, would see interviews that I did with porn stars, or they would see that I interviewed a porn star, and they would tell me, well, I can't book this person on your show, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, did you not know who the president was for 4 years? But, you know, I love the Trump train. I am a huge Trump guy. I love candidate Trump before the last election. When he won it the first time, ironically, won it the first time. Everybody knows what I'm saying there. And I was a fan of Trump running this time. I like candidate Trump. I'm not a big fan of in-office Trump because I think he gets manipulated by the New World Order. But I like this Trump, and I think when he does these events where he gets up there and as Ross Long would say, eviscerates some of these people, like DeSanctimonious and all those clowns. I think it's great. But one of the things that I am just astounded by, and I cannot wait for you to give me your take on this, is when we used to do Jiggy Jag TV, one of my the co-hosts that I had for many a years, Mr. Cousin Chris, who by the way is still with us, he's not dead. I set that up like he's dead. He's not dead. He's still alive. But Chris used to always say that when anybody, whether it was a sports person, political person, whatever, they would get to like the 20-yard line, and then they would fumble the ball back the other direction. And that happened this week with this strike in Detroit with the auto workers. You have Joe Biden, as the great Rush Limbaugh used to call him, Joe Bite Me, which I love that term better than anything anybody's ever come up with. But Joe Biden could have went to the UN. He then could have got on a plane. He could have went to Detroit, and he could have got in line with those striking auto workers, and he could have been like, "Or the Democrats were for the people." But as we all know, with previous strikes, Joe Biden and the Democrats are not really with the people. They're with the multinational corporations that run the people. So what he ends up doing is he gives this up to Trump. He gives him a layup. Because next Tuesday or Thursday, whenever the hell this debate is, he's going to skip the debate. And he's going to go to Detroit. And he's going to do a rally with these striking auto workers. And I'm like, Joe Biden is an idiot. Whoever the hell is advising him needs to be fired. Because this is the simplest goddamn thing I've ever seen in my life. You could go to those striking auto workers and be like, the Democrats, power to the people, all this stuff. Instead, he's hanging out at the UN with the Nazi failed comedian, failed, as Ric Flair would call him, dick dancer, Zelensky. I'm like, what are you doing? Why do the Democrats and these guys keep screwing this up and giving Trump points on the board, Roger?
This is a tough one, Jiggy, because I don't think people are ready for other folks to get like 40% raises and work for 32 hours and get paid for 40, it just seems a bit much. And what is kind of causing the problem also is the inflation. This mandatory, you will make these electric cars that people aren't buying. So it's basically just throwing everything off kilter. I don't really have an answer for it, Jiggy, to be honest with you on this. Because like I say, what the workers for are asking for, it seems very demanding and very pie in the sky. So I usually have a sharp opinion on something. On this, I really don't. Because like I say, you always want to be on the side of the working people. But it just seems, wow. I mean, when you hear some of the figures of what it might come to an hour that they're making, I don't really have a strong opinion on this, Jiggy. You put me on the spot here. What about it? What do you think?
Well, first of all, as the great Conrad Thompson says, there's a lot to unpack here. So first off, the whole thing about the making everybody buy these electric vehicles. Here's the deal. If you want to make people buy electric vehicles, make it so easy they can go out and buy them. Have the government give everybody a check or a subsidy or some sort of crap, and I will be at the auto place tomorrow buying a vehicle. But I'm not going to go buy it just because you go, you need to go buy this vehicle. No, not doing that. Also, the thing that I also don't understand about all this is, you know, what happens if all these people plug their cars in at the exact same time? We have a failing power grid that they've never fixed. And then on top of this, you know, they make these comments about, you know, that they don't want to give the workers, you know, any more money, which, you know, a lot of these guys, they all have been bailed out by the government and all sorts of things, but don't give the workers any cash. And the thing that I don't understand also, which is another quick layup for Trump, and he can score some more points, is Trump has always said, whether he means it or not, it's perfect. If you give people money in their pocket, they will go out and buy things. Like, for instance, all these auto workers, if they pay these guys some more cash, they're going to have cash in their pocket, and they're going to go out They're going to buy the new car. They're going to buy the brand new house. And then if they bought the brand new house, they got to go to Lowe's or Home Depot to buy the stuff so they can build themselves a backyard. And then the people that make the wood and all this stuff, they make money. And it's like, but for whatever reason, multinational corporations do not want anybody to get any cash. And then on top of that, you got Biden and these guys where they, okay, yeah, let's give them, go ahead and give them a raise. Go ahead and give them all a raise. Well, the inflation's going to screw them, and they ain't going to have any money anyway. It's just the craziest deal. I feel like the Will Ferrell character in the movie Zoolander when he says, I feel like I'm taking crazy pills.
Well, I'm very curious to see what Trump is going to say to the auto workers. But I really am I'm very curious to see what his solution will be. He came out. Not to divert from the
topic you're bringing up,
but like with abortion, nobody's talked about that. Nobody's. That's just been too toxic.
I think they realized they cooked their goose on that baby.
And he said, "Look, we have to talk about it, and you have to at one point or another, you have to like say what your position is, and nobody has. And he has come out and said a position. He's against abortion. However." And there need to be limits with time limits and this and that. But he's not against it in the cases of rape, incest, or danger to the mother. I mean, and those those seem to be things, you know, you can have extremists on both sides, but there has to be compromise eventually. And this seems like a pretty good place to start. So I got to tip my cap to him for that. Nobody else would touch the subject. At least he's got the cojones to, like, bring it up and say what his position is. On this United Auto Worker thing, I'm really curious to see what he thinks is going to be a way to resolve this fairly.
Well, the thing that I think is great about Trump is that sometimes, which, you know, I quote this all the time. I probably have sold more books for Stern than actually Stern sold the first time. But if you go back and you look at the at some of the last book that Howard Stern wrote, he has all these segments and interviews and transcripts in there of his interviews with Trump. Trump has always been the same guy forever, even though he originally was a Democrat and he paid for Chelsea's wedding, but then all of a sudden he's a big bad Republican all of a sudden. But the thing is that whether he believes it or not, he gets out there and he says the right stuff. So like he'll get up there at this, if he gets up there at this, this auto worker thing, he'll get up there and he'll be like, ah, power to the people, blah, 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 and all that. He'll do all that. And everybody will cheer. And then you'll have the grandmas with the cowboy hats that have Trump's face on it. And I don't know if you've seen any of these people. You know, I would love to go to a Trump rally just to people watch. Some of these people you see at these rallies. But the thing is that whether he believes it or not, people buy into it. And they're like, oh, yeah, right. They need more money. They need this. They need that. Biden can do the exact same thing. Biden could get out there. They could hand him a script and say, okay, go out there and tell everybody that you're with the workers. And then turn around and go get with Pelosi and the crew and smash the working man like they always do. And you're going to get people to believe it. And then at the end of the day, you're going to have all these people. See, this, we had a guy on. I'm going to try to get this guy on with you. We had a guy on the other day who wrote a book about cults and Trump. And he was talking about the fact that the people who are anti-Trump are like in a cult. And one of the things that I tried to get him to talk about, which he didn't want to do that because he's a rah, rah, rah Trump guy, which is one thing I like about you. You and I are both Trump fans, but we also realize sometimes he's kind of an idiot, but we're not, you know, completely all in on Trump, but we're not completely all in on any of these other people. But one of the things that I was trying to get this guy to kind of, you know, go with was, you are right about the cult thing, because yeah, there are a good collection of people. A lot of them are Democrats, but there's a good collection of people where they just hate Trump to hate Trump. They don't know why, they just hate him. And then on the other side, which is most of the people that are at these rallies, you see these people at these rallies, like David Pakman and Newsmax and OAN and all these people will interview a lot of these people that are coming out of the rallies, and they got the T-shirts and the hats and, oh my God, Trump, 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 Trump. And they'll ask them, you know, a policy that he has or a policy that he's not for. And they're all just like, eh, we love Trump. And it's like, they're in a cult too. And it's like, oh my God, there's like maybe five or six sane people. And I think two of them are on this Skype call. So it's like, I just find it so strange. Just the way people act and behave. Is that your experience with people out in the world?
Look, it's very hard for folks when they have a mic put in their face. We are very closely aligned, you and I, but not 100%.
Yeah.
I'm a little more optimistic, and I have to be. I think we don't have any choice. Like what you said before about the New World Order,
yeah,
that he's really taking these orders from them. If that, I hope to God you're wrong, Jiggy, because if that's the case, we are totally screwed. I mean, the only hope I have...
I should have clarified that. What I mean by that is like when Trump was going to pick his VP, everybody's like, oh, he's going to do this, he's going to do that. And he had said on so many occasions, I'm picking a former general. I'm picking a guy that's got leadership skills. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. And then all of a sudden he's like, oh, Mike Pence. And it's like, he had said on several occasions, on Twitter, I think it was, he didn't like Pence. He didn't know who Pence was. What is this crap? And I think what happened is he got to the point where he was in the club, as they say, and they said, hey, you're picking Pence. And he's like, okay, I'm picking Pence. But the thing was, which I think was amazing, is that he always set, which I got to feel bad for Pence at one point, but he always set Pence up to fail. He would give him projects that were just astronomically, you know, like he gave him the COVID thing, he gave him some of the other things, and Pence just sailed through them, had no problem. And, but, you know, at the end of the day, you know, like now, I think if Trump were to get reelected, or as Sandra Lee likes to say, serving his third term, I don't think you're going to see that out of Trump. I think if the New World Order or any of these guys were to call him on the phone and say, you're going to do this, he's going to be like, don't know who this is, new number, and hang up on these people. And he's going to do whatever the hell he wants. And I think that's part of the reason why a lot of these guys are scared. Because the Democrats don't know what the hell he's going to do. And the NWO doesn't know what he's going to do, but he ain't going to do anything for them. And the Republicans are scared because they're like, what the fuck is he going to do? So I think a lot of these people are scared to death of this guy, which is part of the reason why, if it's a day that ends in Y, they've indicted him.
Look, one of the most encouraging things I've heard in a while, it really uplifted me. I said, really? Wow. George Soros said that if Trump
the guy wins, who I go with the Nazis. Yes, go.
George Soros says if Trump wins, it's going to put a stumbling block in front of the New World Order coming to be. And I'm going,
put that on a T-shirt, baby.
I mean, that's the best thing I could possibly do. I can't think of a better reason to vote for Trump than that. So if he indeed is the only thing between us and this New World Order, then let it be so.
Yeah.
But you have to get behind somebody. You have to have faith in some people, and you have to take a choice at some time. I've got to believe that Trump really is for America, and he will not lead us into being slaves of the United Nations and the European Union and the WHO and the CDC and all these other garbage globalist elite organizations.
Well, one of the things that I liked about Trump when he was running the first time was he had a message. And that's the thing that I really hated about the last time that he ran. He didn't really have a message. And I remember Michael Savage on several occasions was just like, what is he running on? What is the actual thing? It was, reelect me. And it's like, dude, I don't know what the deal with these, and this is a Republican problem across the board. I don't know who these people are that are running these campaigns, but Trump should have run on all of his accomplishments. And that's what he should have run on. Instead, it was, just reelect me. And it's like, reelect you for what reason? And one of the things that happened the last election cycle here in the state of Kansas is we had a guy who was running for governor. He was a Republican. His name was Derek Schmidt, and he was the exiting attorney general. And he had done all sorts of things where he had enacted programs for child trafficking. He had cut down on, you know, illegals getting into Kansas and doing all sorts of things, which you got to run pretty far if you're leaving that border and then running to Kansas, middle of the damn country. But he had done all these things. And when he ran for governor, it was, I'm going to stand up to Joe Biden. What? Like, dude, run on your accomplishments. And that's the thing with Trump. What Trump should have done is he should have said, employment was down, we did this, workers got raises. He should have had all this stuff. Instead, he's just like, well, you know, if you don't reelect me and you get Joe Biden, this will happen. And then, of course, Biden, he is already, if you look at some of his advertising, he's already running on the fact of, well, if you don't elect me, you'll get Trump. And it's like, guys, run on something. Biden should run on something. Even though Biden really hasn't accomplished anything, run on something.
I don't know, Jiggy. I really have I love you, you know, but I've got a different take on it. I mean,
go ahead. That's why we do this. Go ahead, man.
I do think that Trump ran on his record, and he was running on, he said, we're going to make America great, and then the border.
Well, that too.
Lots of things are good, and then the next phrase was, keep America great. In other words, you have to elect him again, otherwise Biden's going to do away with everything he did, and that's exactly what happened. But I don't think that he was, I thought he was trying to get the message out, but certainly the media was of no help. But you could go down a list. I mean, He had amazing accomplishments, particularly when he had zero support from the Democrats. In fact, they were lockstep. They were like a wolf pack. They called themselves the resistance. They tore up his State of the Union address. And he even had
that political theater.
laughing down his nose at him. So he had people in his own party stabbing him in the back. He didn't get a cent for the border. And he still managed to get that wall 90% done. And it could have been finished in weeks. But instead of finishing the wall, Biden said, the material that's there, no, we'll pay for it to sit there and then we'll sell it. So I think he did bring up all the things that he accomplished. He accomplished a staggering amount, frankly.
Yes.
And when you factor in that he had zero, they had nothing but resistance from the entire media, from the entire Democrats, and from half of his own party, I think what he accomplished was quite remarkable.
Yes. We have got the fantastic Roger Homefield with us today. He joins us live here on our big, big broadcast. Roger, do you have a little bit of time? I was going to bring in Larry Tracy. Do you have a little bit of time to hang out with us and
talk? I've got a lot of time.
Oh, I've got a lot of time. Okay. Well, we're going to do this. I'm going to patch in Larry Tracy with us here in just a few seconds. But so why we do all that, Roger? What is the latest with the softball stuff? Because I every once in a while I'll get people who will leave comments on our videos about they want a softball update. So what do you have for us in that area, my friend?
I'll tell you, it's like you have South Florida and then you have the rest of the world. Because what's happening down here, it's just like the movie Cocoon, okay?
Yes.
You've got guys in their 70s. And when they get between those white lines, sliding into bases, hitting screaming line drives, diving for balls, and managing to, for the most part, stay in the game, even with minor injuries, you know, but being in good enough shape, it's really a phenomena, and I can't believe it. And I feel like, you know, I feel like I'm 12 years old all over again. The same trials and tribulations. You want to help the team. You don't want to fail the team. So the latest is I go up and down like a jack-o'-lantern, Keith, as far as the confidence, you know. And I was really thinking maybe I'm getting too old for first base. These balls are zipping in. Very
zipping,
you know, and I'm not getting a good focus of the guy releasing the ball. Anyway, to make a long story short, a game later, you have a good game. Guys are behind you. You have the confidence. I'm playing first base on the Tuesday-Thursday league, and I'm playing second base on the Monday-Wednesday league. Now, that doesn't mean four games a week because each of them have lots of buys. But yeah, the thing about second base, it's unbelievable, Jiggy, that you ask, because, look, I was a trombone player. I could not have a ball hit me in the mouth. So the entire time I ever played first base in sandlot ball, not highly competitive leagues like this, when the ball would come on a short hop, I used to make fun of myself. I called it the sonar scoop. I would scoop the ball as I looked away. And I was making the scoop by sound. Okay. Now you can't get away with that in highly competitive leagues.
Hello, James.
Hey, we have got the fantastic Larry Tracy joining us today here to broadcast.
Does he play softball though?
Larry, have you ever played softball? Have you ever played softball, Larry Tracy?
No, never did.
Okay. Well, we were just chatting here with Roger Homefield about his softball experiences, and we have got the fantastic Larry Tracy with us today. He, of course, joins us here on our big broadcast. And Larry, you are amazing, my friend. So what is the latest news that we should be talking about? Me and Roger will probably have some questions for you, but talk to us about what the latest is in the world of Larry Tracy.
Well, the latest is that Poland has said they're not going to furnish Ukraine any more equipment, any more military equipment. That's strange. It's not for any disagreement with the policy or the war. It's over a grain problem, and I don't fully understand it. About grain coming in and passing through a transit point. I'll have to look into that. But the bottom line is no more Leopard tanks, no more air.